Greetings. I received a series of posts from a Muslim named Teddy. Bless Teddy's heart, he lied and tried to hide that he was a follower of Muhammad. But every post was coming from Didat's combat kit. But best and last of all, he threw himself on his scimitar with Romans 3:7. Let me give you a taste of something you really are going to like! All caps, shouting, I'm so afraid. This is about nobody else but the Creator of Trinity. Creator of Trinity, that's God, right? He's got to mean Yahweh. Creator of Trinity, who confesses to be fabricating and lying about God. Uh-oh, not sounding like he means God. So here it is, and find out if you can swallow it down your throat. Paul at Romans 3:7. That's making me swallow hard just to get ready. If through my falsehood God's truthfulness abounds to his glory, then I am being considered as a sinner. Lo, what a justification. Oh, he's got me. Someone, help! Heimlich! I just swallowed my tongue laughing at this poor soul. As always, never ever accept what a Mohammedan says the Bible says. Be a good Berean and look it up in context. Let's look at what Teddy got so terribly wrong. Romans 3:1. What advantage then has the Jew? Or what profit is there of circumcision? Realize that chapter markings are arbitrary. And we've just jumped into the middle of a lengthy discourse. There could rightly be a whole video series about this teaching. Suffice it to say, he, Paul, is continuing an argument about the law, circumcision, and grace. Romans 3:1, what advantage then has the Jew, or what profit is there of circumcision? Much every way, chiefly because that unto them were committed the oracles of God. The Jews were given God's laws, so the Jews are special. If you've got a problem with that, you've got a problem with God. Jesus even directly addressed this. Jesus was speaking to a Samaritan woman. John 4:22, you worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from, the Jews. The covenant of God, of which circumcision was a part, was with the Jews. And here, Jesus rather directly reveals he is the Christ. John 4:25, the woman says to him, I know that Messiah is coming, who is called Christ. When he comes, he will tell us all things. Jesus said to her, I, who speak to you, am he. So if you have any doubt, Jesus said he was the Christ. Let's get back to the Paul admitted lying jihad. Romans 3:2, much every way, chiefly because that unto them were committed the oracles of God. The prophets of God were sent to Israel and to no other nation. Then, as part of Paul's argument, he is going to address partial belief. For what if some did not believe? Shall their unbelief make the faith of God without effect? Restated, if some in Israel did not believe, is God's message somehow worthless now, of no effect? The answer to these rhetorical questions is in the very next verse. God forbid. Yea, let God be true, but every man a liar, as it is written, that thou might be justified in thy sayings, and might overcome when thou art judged. Colloquially, this says, it does not matter what men say or argue. God is right. True. As it is written, that thou mightst be justified in thy sayings, and mightst overcome when thou art judged. This is from Psalms 51:4. Against you, you alone, in some translations, O God, I have sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you, God, are justified when you speak and blameless when you judge. Paul is basing his argument on the Old Testament prophets. This verse speaks of sinning against God and that God is blameless when he judges. From that verse, Paul is about to highlight that our unrighteous behavior actually commends or supports, proves God's righteousness. But if our unrighteousness commend the righteousness of God, what shall we say? Is God unrighteous who takes vengeance? I speak as a man. This is a pretty common humanist argument. Only those today who do not bother to read think they have recently created this argument. Violence is evil, so isn't God judging and punishing an evil act? God forbid, for then how shall God judge the world? Paul has just answered his straw man argument. When God judges, does that make God unrighteous? Can you hear the liberal argument in your head?
The Bible says don't judge.
In fact, the Bible does not say do not judge, period, full stop. Think it does? Well, let's go look at where Jesus addressed the topic. Matthew 7:1, do not judge or you will be judged. For with the same judgment you pronounce, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, or the standard, it will be measured to you. The whole statement does not just say not to judge. It warns, or cautions, or advises you to only judge if you are willing to be judged by the standard you apply. You will be judged by the standard you use to judge others. And so God, who was willing to be judged and was judged, can judge and still remain holy and righteous. So Paul is in the middle of a logical discourse and argument. God forbid, for then how shall God judge the world? And then we come to the verse that Teddy has ripped out of the context. Please pay attention, Teddy, and my Muslim viewers. The leaders of Islam you respect show themselves to be ignorant. Paul is about to offer another argument, and then teach about it. Let me first describe his argument to you, and then we'll read several translations. Can the kingdom of God be advanced by telling lies, and the teller of the lies be justified to do so? If you are Muslim, you should really stop and ponder this point. And I think your heart is telling you why. Islam is a system that allows and even encourages telling lies to advance Islam. Teddy, the Muslim, who thought this jihad was clever and effective, also lied, thinking he could hide his religion. Bless his poor heart. Teddy thinks, yes, Allah will forgive my lies if I can trick a Christian away from the gospel of Jesus. And yet this verse Teddy uses is actually Paul making an argument against such behavior. Talk about your jihad being beheaded with your own scimitar. So what is the argument Paul is about to make? If, and if means a hypothetical point, if Paul lied to advance the kingdom, shouldn't the fact that good is being accomplished outweigh the fact a sin was committed to accomplish the good? Others have simplified this rather complicated explanation to the following. The end justifies the means. King James, for if the truth of God has more abounded through my lie unto his glory, why yet am I also judged as a sinner? If my lies were to cause God's truth to abound, why am I still considered a sinner? What is wrong with lies, if lies can be used to accomplish the agenda for Allah's jihad? And this is the critical point to understand if you are Muslim and have any respect for God. Paul is not declaring in this verse a confession that he has lied to spread the word of God. He is attempting to teach that sin is always sin. Sin is bad. Even though your human mind wants to think it has some kind of good side effect. This is the NIV translation. Someone might argue, if my falsehood enhances God's truthfulness and so increases His glory, why am I still condemned as a sinner? The New Living Translation. But someone might still argue, how can God condemn me as a sinner if my dishonesty highlights His truthfulness and brings Him more glory? The English Standard. But if through my lie God's truth abounds to His glory, why am I still being condemned as a sinner? The Berean Study Bible. However, if my falsehood accentuates God's truthfulness to the increase of His glory, why am I still condemned as a sinner? The Berean Literal. But if in my lie the truth of God abounded to His glory, why am I also still judged as a sinner? So understand two things from this. First, Paul is not confessing that the gospel he preached is a lie of some kind. Paul is only offering a hypothetical argument, a straw man to disprove the concept that the end justifies the sin. And second, this teaching damns Islam, which allows and encourages lies to be told to spread Islam. You see, the Muslim Teddy tried to hide his obedience to Satan's jihad for Muhammad. This was his lie. And yes, I say Satan's jihad because Satan is the father of lies. If your religion cannot convince someone of its truth in a clear light of honesty, it is an evil lie from hell, brother. But Paul is not finished teaching the Christian response to stupid accusations. His teaching style is to present the argument and then address it. Why not say, as some slanderously claim that we say, let us do evil that good may result. Their condemnation is deserved. In his time, some falsely accused Paul of teaching the practice of evil. As some slanderously claim that we say, let us do evil that good may result. Paul also continues this teaching in Romans 6:1. What then shall we say? Shall we continue in sin so that grace may increase? God forbid! How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? Paul concludes Romans 3:8 by condemning those who spread such teaching. Their condemnation is deserved. I hope you now understand what Romans 3:7 actually means. And I hope you honestly consider which religion is based on truth and which is spread by lies. Lies that the Apostle Paul actually condemns, not admits to. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.